evening, everybody, and welcome to tonight's Select Board meeting. We'll get started here with our consent agenda. So on the consent agenda, I have minutes of...
Actually, we don't have any minutes for you, so if we could move on to the warrants, please.
So we have warrants PR 1638, 1639. We have a one-day alcohol liquor license for the top of the campus. Mr. Christopher Dreher? His appointment?
Dreher.
An appointment to the Cultural Council and the Cemetery Committee. And then we have UMass surplus vehicles, acquisition of 3 vehicles. Does anybody want to take anything else off?
I would like the two appointees for the DPW taken off so we can discuss them, since we have Marlo here this evening to talk regarding that. I saw that, so. Anybody following at home? Make a motion, accept?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, so Mr. Marlo, you want, or Marlo, would you like to?
Mr. Marlo.
No, he liked that. It worked out pretty well there, huh?
Mr. Warner, would you?
Much better than my job now.
Would you like to take up the 2 DPW guys?
Sure, we have two of our workers in the drinking water division, Mr. Liam Kelly and Anthony Horton. They both reached their probationary end date of March 21st. I sent the letters along to the board. They both have already obtained the licensing needed to work in the water plant, and they're pursuing their other licenses. Particularly Anthony Horton received a backflow license already, which we can do our own backflow. I should say he got a certification. We can do our own backflows now rather than hire out. So that's a bonus to the town. I've only been here 4 weeks, but my 4 weeks working with these two, they certainly have taken ownership of the water system and are dedicated to it. And every day they're striving to get better and better and learn more about it. So I recommend we promote.
I'd like to echo that too, and I know that Mr. Kelly and Mr. Horton have done a great job. Mr. Klamoski was looking for a long time, and we were really trying to find people that were qualified to do that. Mr. Horton came in with some great resume. Mr. Kelly did it all on his own. He went out there and got his license to start with on his own before he even came to work for us, and they've really turned out to be, they do a great job at this point in time. So I would strongly recommend that the probation period's over, that we follow Mr. Marlowe's suggestion, and that we put them on for full time.
Was that a motion, Jerry?
It was a motion.
Okay, I'll second that.
Any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we'll do public comment. Does anybody wish to make a comment?
I would. That tonight on HPAC 1, which is channel 191 on your TVs, that the Mothers Club candidates night from last night will be shown starting at 8 o'clock. So you only have to watch us for an hour. 8:15, excuse me. So 8:15, you can turn your TVs over and get to see what you missed last night. Channel 191 at 8:15.
And I would like to make an apology to everybody who's going to watch that show and watched it in live yesterday. I realize that when the Mothers Club invites you to actually make a statement or to that you have an ability to make a statement, they're actually not asking you if you want to. They are telling you to make a statement. So I apologize. I didn't have anything ready for last night. I really thought I was just coming for questions, and I apologize for that. But everyone else who was there did a very fine statement and did a very good job. And we have some very good candidates running for office tonight, this time. Okay, any...
Versus last year?
I was going to let that
go. I'm a little sensitive.
There's a bigger belt next later.
We always have good candidates, don't we?
Yeah, I would think so.
We do. All right, is there any more comments?
No. Just a quick thing. I spent about 3 hours with Highway Superintendent Mike this morning and going over all the ins and outs of their department, what they want for the future and what they need to pick up. We ended discussion talking about the trash around town, and he indicated to me that we could utilize trial court employees to start cleaning it, and I guess I'm looking for the board's blessing to let the Highway Department use that thing. It's no charge to us, at least clean the gateways, you know, and later on at one point I organized volunteers for Earth Day to to clean, I would be willing to do that again to clean the rest of the town if they clean the gateways.
Good. So this is a public comment period, and we're not allowed to comment on this because it's not on the agenda.
Can we ask clarifying questions?
We're not actually supposed to discuss it. It's not
Less
on the agenda.
Questions later.
It's not on the agenda. So.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So we're still a little early for our 7:15 appointment. So would the DPW director like to talk about the Route 9 road widening project?
Sure. Quick update. We're expecting a pre-construction date at any time here. Is the latest on that. We don't have a date set yet, but I expect to hear from them any day now for a pre-construction for the actual project. As we know, it's a complete project through DOT for about $3 million. I'm currently in discussions with Mr. Massey, Rick Massey, with Mass DOT. There was a glitch on the tabulation sheets that Mass DOT had presented to me, and Bayside engineer airing firm had presented to me. So I'm in discussions with them now because there's some discrepancies in the amount of materials and the monies. Tonight there was an addendum to be signed for engineering services to be increased. It was close to double. I was looking for another $21,900 was the original for design on the project. And I believe we're looking for another $19,600 for additional construction services if needed. I would ask that we probably not sign that addendum tonight until I can swim through the rest of these indiscrepancies with the project as far as the tabulations. So further information to follow as soon as I can come up with those answers.
So the contract with Bayside is solely for construction services during the project?
Project manager.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So what happened was when the tabulation sheets come in different, Mr. Massey volunteered to work with Bayside to get the answers we were looking for. There was three specific items.
Flowable fill. Police details.
Officers.
Engineering.
Engineering, there was actually four because something popped up to me in the blacktop area too. There was a significant difference of money. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay.
So yesterday, Mr. Nixon and Linda Sanderson and I attended a DEP meeting for the SRF. If you'd like to speak to that, Mr. Nixon?
Or sure.
As far as the funding
so
piece.
We went to the SRF training. In the past, SRF funding has required a very specific form of the borrowing vote. We did borrow for this project back in October 20th, 2015. The amount that we had borrowed and approved by town meeting was $377,000, which is ample for our portion of this particular project, even given the potential change orders that are there. So we have the money in place. DEP has changed its requirements so that prior vote now seems to stand for our appropriation for this project under the SRF program. This is good news in a number of different ways, and Linda can amplify on that. But first of all, it means you can remove two articles from your annual town meeting warrant as unneeded at this point. Second is that it gives us a step forward in the process. And as you know, that we've been late to this process because we were given the opportunity for SRF funding through Senator Rosenberg's generous efforts. So we've been able to advance this project significantly by the news that we received from DEP yesterday. Do you want to talk a little bit more about that?
Sure. I think that I know that the town clerk had already gathered the information based on the article that we had passed last October for submitting to bond council and borrowing under general borrowing before we had this opportunity to do the water, go through the water fund. And yes, we did think that we had to then change it for the spring town meeting. So we were able to submit the information this morning, the certifications that had been done for us on the fall one, and have we heard back?
We haven't heard back.
We got an oral okay for it yesterday, but we thought we wanted to actually submit the wording this morning and make sure that they come back and say, yes, that article is sufficient. And then we will know for sure that we don't need to go to the spring town meeting with it, and that will, yes, it moves us ahead at least 6 weeks.
Easy, and we don't have to incur additional expenses with bond council. So it was a very productive meeting, as well as being able to meet the people face-to-face that we're going to have to work with in order to expedite this project under their program requirements. So things seem to be shaping up in a very positive way there.
Any other questions?
That's good.
No.
We like less money.
So just, so this is a direct reimbursement job we're signed up with Mass Highway for. There won't be an additional surprise at the end, is my understanding. And just questions I have, or that's all. And then they won't let the project, or won't give the notice to proceed until we actually sign what they believe is the number for engineering services on the contract. That's what we're all talking about here with the change order, correct?
Correct.
I just love Mass Highway sometimes. Okay, any other questions about the project?
No, we'll stay tuned for the next episode.
I'm working on it.
Yep.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Yeah.
All right. So, we have budget hearings tonight, or budget presentations from some department heads.
Do you want to say what that is?
She's only here for that one thing.
We don't know.
She's a big one.
I know. She looks like one. Okay, so, all right, so we are a little early, but we will, just as I was reminded, we will not be talking about electrical aggregation tonight. We'll let the lawyers talk a little more about that, and the town administrator talk a little more with them about that. So we will go ahead and start with the budget presentations. And the first one I have on my list is the assessor.
My budget is pretty much straightforward compared to last year. We're looking for $400 in three expense accounts. And also for the GIS expansion, we had a presentation back in January to increase the GIS by adding password protection so that departments that have sensitive information could utilize it. The schools with busing routes, town clerk could have street lists on there, or residents, but it would include those under 17 that only she could get into, or if the police needed access to it. And police and fire, flammable fluid permits could be placed on there so that if fire department is responding to a call, they can access it from the field and see what is exactly stored at that site. Or if the police are responding, they could just call up and it would have who's living there, if there's any gun permits, or any other things.
So that's on the secure side.
Yeah, that would be added on there. Right now, other departments could add things on, and there's no additional cost, but whatever gets added on is available to everybody who has internet access.
Okay. Any questions about this budget?
Just one quick question. Dan, did you have a chance to review the IT report that came out?
I looked through it real quick, but seeing how it was close to, I believe, 300 pages.
Right, okay.
Yeah, I haven't really gone through it in full.
Okay, I just didn't know. I don't think there's any impact to your budget, but that was one of the things we just wanted people to double check.
Yeah, I don't think there was anything in there that directly related to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, other than the best practices and recommending the GIS.
Yeah, there wasn't any expenses, I think, associated with my department in the budget.
Okay.
And one other thing that we were looking at, the town clerk and I had discussed, reallocating the assessor's clerk, selectman's clerk, town clerk hours. When the position was set up, it was originally In my office, it's 20 hours a week in my off, based out of my office, but it works for, the person works for me. Also fills in the selectman's office. And they're paid 10 hours a week out of there and 5 hours a week out of the town clerk. We're looking at reallocating those 10 hours in the selectman's office back into our budgets because we're looking forward to the future. And if there's any retirements or personnel changes, we're looking at it's going to be really hard to get somebody to come in for 5 hours a week that could would be effective.
Okay.
Working in either department.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, I think part of the discussion we had with Bridget's departure and the point of hiring a temp was so that we would have an opportunity to take more holistic view of the staffing at town hall and try to figure out, you know, what's going to make the most sense going forward. So make sure that consideration's wrapped into that discussion, probably find out more about it from all of you in terms of your thoughts behind how those hours would be utilized currently.
So I just have one more question for you. Our assessing department function seems to be it's very robust. As we think about possibly going out to other communities and talking to them, would this be one of the areas that we might be able to maybe outsource out to them to bring their work into us and us be able to be a provider for them?
I'm not sure if we would be able to absorb outside work in our office. Revals are extremely intense, and running one for another, basically for another town, there'd be no way that we would be able to do anything in our office while that was going on.
Okay. So as we think about this, thank you for your input. It might come up more and more. So as we think about some type of maybe offering some of our services out to other communities, that might be something we may be looking at. So.
Yeah, I think most of the communities that offer that type of service have more than one person in the office full time.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Any other questions for the assessor?
No. Well, how would that be reallocated, the hours?
We were looking at adding 5 hours to my department and 5 hours to Jess's department, but not changing the essential function of the position. That the position would still fill in the selectman's office.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right, the accountant's budget.
There's not much of a change to the accountant's budget.
I don't think many people know who you are. Would you like to introduce yourself to everybody?
I'm Justin Cole. I'm the town accountant. I'm the principal for Bay State Municipal Accounting.
Thank you.
So there's approximately a $4,000 decrease in our budget for next year. That's largely made up of the differential between the previous town accountant's salary and our contract amount. There's also a small portion that's items that we backed out of the budget for mileage, professional development, dues and memberships that we already hold ourselves so that the town would not need to pay for that. The total ends up being a little bit more than a 4% decrease. The contract amount for us specifically is $5,000 even for the 12-month period next year, ending June 30th, 2017. And that's consistent with what we had proposed to the town this past fall when we started our initial engagement.
Okay. Any questions from the board?
Yeah, a couple.
Go ahead.
So the assistant town accountant, are those the hours that are shared with inspections?
Correct. That's the 10 hours a week that that's being shared with the inspection services.
Okay. And then in terms of information technology, any, again, same question with this information technology report that came through. Did you have a chance to take a look at it to see if there was any impact?
I read through it and I reviewed it. I don't think there's any direct impact, you know, to the accounting office per se. The accounting system is hosted online in the cloud, so there's no town infrastructure needed for that. And I mean, at least at the current time, you know, we're providing all of our own technology infrastructure in order to complete the job here at Town Hall. You know, eventually, you know, there'll need to be a little bit of upgrade to the town captain's office, you know, in terms of, you know, minor things like, you know, a computer and things like that. But overall, I don't think there's anything in there that really affects the office.
Okay, so no software modules that you're recommending that we add on to the existing?
Not at this time.
Not at this time, okay. And then question for you is just, would the change from the salary line down, is that, has the benefits that would typically be aired on that also been reduced?
Well, we've avoided some costs in the benefit line, so on rough estimate of about $30,000 to $35,000 of cost avoidance on benefits. So on the 900 level budgets, you'll see that we've added some increases there, but they might have been a little higher if we had a benefited position there.
Right, so it's been taken into account, so
yes.
I'm asking.
Yep.
Okay. All right, thanks.
So my big question is, how is the paperless warrant process coming?
We can, I think the biggest hang up right now is just, there's a time constraint on it. We have to, the internet bandwidth here for us to scan it, upload it, and put it into the cloud to get it ready to go. It takes a significant amount of time here, given the speed of the internet or the unreliability of the speed of the internet into the building. One of the things that we're going to explore is taking the warrant off-site, processing in our office, and seeing if we can upload it there. But right now, the demo one that we did, I mean, you guys are familiar with the average size of the warrant. The demo one that we did, it took us an hour to upload it, which is just dead time because it takes enough bandwidth that we can't even get into the accounting system while it's uploading. So it ends up being just dead time sitting here. So we're going to try to experiment with uploading it outside of the building to see if we can get it going. But that's the only kind of hurdle at this point.
So since that was one of the major findings in the IT report and one that seems to be most easily fixable, do we have a timeline? Something that, I mean, we shouldn't even be wasting our...
So Justin and I had a conversation about how much money is left in that computer account. So
yeah.
I now have a figure, and I'm pursuing with a vendor a invoice or an estimate, and so we should be able to pull that trigger.
Okay, because I mean,
shortly.
If we get that fixed, yeah. Then you may not even need to conduct your experiment, because we really do want the paperless warrant, don't we?
Yes. We do. Every once in a while, I can't find my key to remember to get in here. okay, any other questions for the accountant? All right, so thank you very much. And we'll probably be talking to you a little later, trying to get an update on how things are going in the accounting world doing this type of methodology. We'll probably want to bring you in and talk a little bit with you and some of the other people about how the overall system is working and how we think it's going. So that's something to expect in the future.
Okay.
So thank you. All right, let's go to the treasurer.
All right, there's a lot of numbers here for budgets, but it comes down to our own budget, the debt and interest budget, which is broken into two parts, and the benefits budgets and the insurance budgets. So I will go through them in that order. First, budget 145 is our town treasurer's actual budget. For the most part, there are some items we haven't fully spent out from the current year. We haven't been through a full year yet, so I've mostly level funded those. I did, one of the large leaps is in the professional services. That's on our biannual OPEB audit, So that only pops in every couple of years. So it, that budget will go down 6,000 and then up 6,000 every other year. I think at one point they were trying to keep it in as an even amount, but as long as you know to expect that, I think we'll put that in for this coming year.
Does that figure not seem overly large to you for the amount of work it would take to review the OPEB budget?
It's an actuary, the actuarial report of is what they're doing each year in assessing our new, doing a new assessment of the liability, of what our amount of contribution would be over time, how much we have put in, how much that has impacted our future contributions. It's a projection ahead based on the number of employees we have in every category. Sure, I mean, all of our audit figures are kind of large, but I don't know that we really have an option. There aren't a lot of sources to go to, and I think that's about just what it costs. I'm glad we only have to do it every other year. I think because of our bonding, because of the borrowing that we do need to have audits. There are towns that don't do the level of borrowing that we do and can get away without having audits on a regular basis, but we are at that level, and so we do need to have the audits. I know that it was just asked for from you last week. The state just called and asked us for our most recent OPEB audit.
And they're required every 2 years?
Every 2 years.
Yep, by law.
We're using the same actuary?
We are. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's Parker Elmore. Yep. I think we've had him. I think we've only had the OPEB account for 3-4 years, so yeah, I mean, it's been him since the beginning. Mm-hmm. But I will consider that going forward and see if we have
4 years worth of notes and $6,000 for an audit. Mm-hmm.
There's actually a fair amount of work that does go into it because the data changes 2 years later. You're dealing with a completely different demographic population and insurances that have to be factored into it. So unfortunately, it's not the kind of thing where there's some sort of, you know, initial upfront investment of work and then you can leverage off of that. You have to completely redo it.
I know with our regular audit auditors, we have them for a few years. It gets them a chance to get used to our figures and then work with them and make it, and to benefit from the time that they've invested with us. But then it is a good idea to go out to bid and try again. So we'll have to talk about at what point we might want to do that again with both the regular and perhaps with the OPEB. The other change is with the assistant treasurer's salary, and I want to speak to that. There was a time, and it was 2 years ago, and the first part of last year's budget too, where the assistant treasurer personally worked 40 hours a week. 30 hours was showing up in this budget, and 10 hours was in the accountant's budget. So she was working 40 hours a week and being paid at that rate. And it had been an issue for a while that we had been cited on having someone who was working in both departments at once. There was a potential conflict of interest. And so with the change in treasurer last year and change in other positions, they did split that up, that the 10 hours went over to the accountant side and 30 to treasurer's side. That resulted in a personal cut in 10 hours for the treasurer, which I did put in for an extra 5 hours last year, and she's up to 35. And so I have requested the extra 5, and this will restore her to the hours that she had. Now, I know this is a level services budget, and I'm not saying what we could do with 5 extra hours. I want to make the point that these 5 extra hours are already being worked. Very often, it's into comp time. Because of the variation in the workload in our office and some extraordinary workloads that we've had this year with dealing with the Affordable Care Act and a new reporting that was done this year, there would be a week that there would be an extra 15 to 20 hours, and then there would be comp time, and then time off, and then getting behind in areas. It's been like a seesaw trying to deal with comp time and then taking the comp time off. So I just wanted to make that point that we are working hard to get that back within the hours that were allocated, but it seems fair in the meantime to perhaps restore that to the level it was at and to pay her for the hours that are being put in and not to have to put in an extraordinary amount of comp time on an irregular basis. And that's it for regular budget? Any more questions on that?
No, go ahead.
Okay, next is the interest and debt schedules, 710 and 750. The total between debt and interest, 969,650. I did do up a slightly different breakdown of that today, but kept it at this 969,650 because we already had it in at that amount, and this was mostly subject to debt exclusion, and therefore the receipts also reflect this at 969,650. A difference between when we were preparing this in January and now is that when we were looking at it in January, we were planning to go out for perhaps $1 million bond to take care of all of the authorized borrowing to date, and including the water borrowing for $377,000. When the watering shifted over and we realized some of the expenses weren't actually going to be incurred in this fiscal year, the amount of borrowing that we actually had to do under the general fund came down quite a bit. And so we are only borrowing in fiscal 16 what has actually been being spent in fiscal 16. So if you, in the sheet that you have, I've got three columns there. One is, it says fiscal 17 prior debt. This is the debt and interest for the borrowings that are already in place. And it's the past borrowings and the amount that they that is required for them for fiscal 17. And the next column then is our estimate of what the borrowing would cost for what we're going out for this year. So $170,000 in new long-term principal and $11,000 in new interest. The allocation then...
Can we just pause for a second?
Sure.
I think the select board are trying to find this online.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
And there's a handout that...
It was a separate sheet.
Handout
I did
that Linda prepared for us today. It's in
so it's not the second attachment that has the long-term debt on it?
Exactly. It's in your package for today.
That's a horse of a different color.
The totals are the same. I was trying not to mess with you too much.
Yeah, the bottom line is the same. That's it. Sorry for the interruption.
Okay. Yeah, so the so you see the total there, 969,650 is what you were looking at before. The breakdown is a little different. We're able to pay more in principal and less in interest because we're borrowing less overall, and we're going to try and get more of that principal paid off in fiscal 17. So we make more, we make room for the borrowing that will come on board at the beginning of fiscal 17. So I think that's good news that the that more of the same tax dollars is going into paying off principal. I like that. So that's it on the debt and interest. It's up there. Then we get into the 900. I think that comes through. I don't know exactly what you're looking at, but if you're looking at, what do they have, page 79 out of the...
right, so starting on
yes,
page,
we do.
Okay,
page
all right.
79.
So all of those, all of these appear on that one sheet, though I have it broken down a little. Okay. So yes, the retirement amount, what accounts for that decrease in $17,000? Each year we are sent an amount from Hampshire County Retirement System telling us what it's going to cost us the following year. They tell us, they give us an amount as if we were going to make it in two payments, one on July 1 and one on July on January 1. They also give us a reduced figure, of that higher figure that they give us for the year, which is that 946,872 amount. And then they say, but if you pay it all up front on July 1, if you're able to do that, there is a significant reduction. We would only pay $929,264. That's a savings of $17,608. It's not an exact dollar savings because we are paying some money 6 months earlier, but it still is, we did do a calculation, it still does come out significantly in our favor. Now, in the last few years, I think that what the Treasurer's Office has tried to do, and which we obviously try to do again this year, is put the full amount in, and then if we can't make it, we're all set, we're protected, but we're going to make it a big effort and leave that extra $17,000 in the budget to be spent in other ways and make every effort to make sure we've got the cash flow in place to pay that full amount on July 1.
Workers' comp, $72,000. That's about almost a 10% increase from the year before. I didn't do much work on that one, but that's something that David and John worked together and seems to be sort of, we're hitting the middle of a path there for the potential increase on that line.
Yeah, it's worth pausing here for a moment and just looking at your prior history on workers' comp. You were above $100,000
yes.
for
oh,
a
absolutely.
Couple of years. Through the work of the safety committee in particular, we've been able to manage on those risk losses, and you'll see that we dropped from $111,000 to $46,000, and we started to drift a little bit back up to 65.
A little bit's $20,000 a year. Why is that so significant? I mean, we dropped a significant 55,000 one year, but we climbed up the next year by 20. Is
right.
Loss ratio is true.
Loss ratio.
Okay.
Yeah. And so we will not receive this number until the true number until after town meeting. So 72,000 is our best guess of where we think we're going to be.
Okay. Next is the unemployment line, 27,000. We calculate unemployment costs this year based on the outstanding claims and the potential claims, and it was at the time claims that were already in and what the outside amount was that we would have needed to spend on those claims. So you know, without itemizing, which is probably not a good idea, that outside amount would have come to 27,000. We don't think we're going to be spending that much this year. We don't know, though. I mean, they can come up anytime. Even once we've had a claim and the person becomes employed, they can become unemployed again at that job and claim back on us. So we know what our outside liability is on each of the people that we have.
Where's our actuals from 14 and 15? Yeah.
So maybe we had no claims?
No, that's not. The reason why you're not seeing the actuals is because in the past, the town set aside money in an article, and then we would draw from that article over time then replenish it. And so we were on a 3-year cycle of set aside $25,000 to $50,000, run on that, and then refill the tank on as we went along. And we made a decision several years ago that that was not the best way to manage those costs. So we started baking it into the budget. We still have a balance left in the prior article that we can call upon if we need to. But at some point, that article is going to be depleted. So we need to have this as part of our expected annual appropriations. We agreed upon a figure of 25,000 in FY16 for this current year. We decided to cut that number in half as part of our budget balancing exercise. But thinking about 25 as your baseline, then 27 would be the expected number for FY17.
All right. I know the Finance Committee, and I was on it at the time, wanted to see an annual budget amount and not just be asked every 3 or 4 years to fill up that fund again and we'll bring it down. They wanted to see what the actual expenses were on an annual basis, and this way we'll see that. We have now $27,000 still sitting in a trust fund for the unemployment, so if we were to run over, we have that money there. But it does look like we're going to make the $12,000 this year, but once again, there's 3 more months left,
But for historical, shouldn't we understand the number anyways? I hear what you're saying
yes,
about the funding for it, but shouldn't we understand what we're spending anyways so that we can fund it at a rate next year for what we anticipate from a 3-year average from the years before?
I think that's a good idea, but it isn't necessarily based on an average because it's an actual individual claim.
Yeah.
If you want me to get that figure, what was actually spent, I certainly can do that for you.
Thanks.
So far, year to date, we're $5,000. So that's why I think we're going to be okay for this year. So,
are we ever challenging any unemployment claims? Or
Yes, we are. We are challenging, and we've had some administrative hearings, and win some, lose some, and that's how it's going. Sometimes we've been able to get it out on the questionnaire stage. Sometimes we've had to go down, and we have attended hearings this year. And we had a telephone hearing too, so we've had a few hearings. There's been an average of about a claim one to two claims a month, and now we've had the last couple months nothing. So I think it depends on what's going on in the town and why people are leaving. But it is done in-house now. There was a time when they were contracting out and didn't find that the success rate was any better outside. And I think that was the idea. It was to save time in the treasurer's office and to improve outcomes. And it wasn't happening. So I think that we're going to work at on getting good at it ourselves and hope that that helps. Okay. What's next? I've lost
health insurance.
Get back to the beginning here. Whoops. Okay, health insurance, $1,225,000. That's budget. Thank you, Don. Okay, that's done by, based on calculations on using the new rates, and it's up a bit from last year. But you know, we spend exactly what we need to spend. There's not a lot of flexibility on that. When people are entitled to take insurance, they take it at the level they want to, and we pay the employer's share. Life insurance is a smaller amount, $2,500, a dollar for to an employee, $1.39 a retiree, calculated out, comes to about just a bit under $2,500. Once again, if they take it, that's the amount that we pay. 916 is Medicare. That's an easy one. It's a basically a 1.45% of the salary. That's it. Let's see, an OPEB contribution. So that OPEB contribution, last year we made it in the fall. We amended the budget, which had been cut out of last spring. We went to town meeting in the fall and upped it to $245,000, which is still a bit under what the recommended amount is for us, but it's been a significant increase each year. And I know it was a hard number to reach, and so rather than go make the big leap up to what the next level was, we have had talks and talked with our advisors and thought that we could leave it at $245,000 and apply the 2.5% increase each year. And that way it would be in the budget, increasing about the rate of the budget, be something that we know the town was able to handle the 245. Hopefully they can handle that 2.5% increase on an annual basis. We will get to that 269 figure that we're trying to get to in a matter of years, and we will probably make the 30-year payoff. At some point, we will hopefully have enough in there that we'll be able to make a significant difference in how our long-term liability, how our unfunded liability is calculated, and that would be terrific. Right now, our unfunded liability is about $6.9 million. I say right now, that's as of the last audit, which was a year ago. So I don't know exactly what it is at the moment, but we're about 6.9, and we hope that that can come down as we continue to make these contributions. But at some point the town decided it was important to make these on an annual basis, and I will say it has helped. It has helped in when we're doing the borrowing and in our when we're being evaluated for
bond rating. Yeah.
Just going back to the health insurance, a while back, the town voted to stop offering health insurance to part-time elected officials, but we grandfathered individuals. Do we know how much of that do you know is related to people who were grandfathered?
There are four part-time elected officials who are still qualified to receive the benefit that's spread out among some of your departments. That annual cost is estimated for FY17 to be $44,000. Okay. That's significantly down from when you first started. You made the change back in 2010, mm-hmm. and you had quite a few part-time elected officials who qualified for the benefit. Mm-hmm. But as election cycles have come and gone, fewer and fewer people are now on the rolls.
Okay. That's good. Good.
Okay, and the last one is the town insurances.
you know, they are what they are. Police, fire, accident. We pay those premiums.
And again, we won't know this number until after town meeting, but this is based upon our best guess of where we are and what our loss runs have been.
Yep. It's about 1,700 increase over what we spent the current year, just to bring it up to an even 45, and hopefully that will be enough.
Any other questions?
I think that's it.
No other questions on the board? So then my only question goes back to debt and interest. We know we put together a spreadsheet earlier about where we were, when debt would be rolling off. We have a sizable chunk that may be rolling off soon. So mm-hmm. do we have that updated so we can possibly use it in the next couple of meetings when we start talking about our fees for land purchases and stuff like that? So.
The most recent one of those debt schedules dates to August 2015, so we can do an update from there.
Well, I've been keeping it updated, but I also manipulate a little bit from time to time because we don't know exactly what the current amount is going to be. And when I say manipulate, what I'm saying is I'm trying to the amount, as I said before, the amount we are actually have to borrow is down quite a bit. And then I have an option of trying to see whether we want to pay that over 3 years, over 5 years, how we want to do that. And in light of, and I think it's worth a discussion on this subject at some point, but if we can move those payment terms short, then that will also, then some more of the borrowing will be out of the way by the time you do have some larger purchases, which is, I think, what you're talking about, fiscal 2021, where we're going to have a lot come off the rolls. Do we want this new borrowing to come off at that same time so that we're ready to go, or do we want to spread it out and bring more interest? So these are, you know, choices that we're making. So, but I will make a choice, and I'll put those figures in, and I'll have them for you.
Okay, thank you.
Updated schedule.
There's no opportunity with rates at this point in time. There's no opportunity with rates for the debt that we have now. The rates are lower than available today that you currently have on the debt.
You mean
refinancing?
Yeah.
The debt? No, I'm really just talking about the new debt. Our old financing is under that, we still have $3.5 million bond, which was, I don't think that we're going to want to refinance that. We're not doing a bond right now, a new bond. They're not worthwhile for under $1 million, really. So we're doing short-term bonds, which what the short-term bond does is give us that flexibility of determining that we want to pay a larger amount of the principal off in the first year. We're not stuck with a payment schedule over 5 years. So that's what I'm trying to do, is keep that debt interest schedule, debt and interest payments that the taxpayers pay even, and bring up and pay more of the principal in the earlier years, get that out of the way, spare them some interest, and be ready to move on to some of these other projects.
Good. All right. I think we're ready for the next one. Town tax collector.
I only have a couple of changes. Point Software has advised me of a couple of increases. They're small forms. Are increasing, and then software licensing. I put in $300 because we need chairs. The chair that I sit in is over 25 years old, and Kim, we've both been through the chair dump over in the senior center, and they're junk. So I have that in there. I've increased tuition and meetings. Both Kim and I need to be recertified. And then I've increased the office supplies $50, which reflects what we actually spent last year.
Okay. Any questions? Mm-hmm. You got up easy there.
Yeah.
keep going up 0.72% on your budget, and I think it'll be easy discussions.
Yeah, so, all right.
Nice job. Thanks.
All right. Town clerk.
Okay, and again, mine's pretty cut and dry. The only change I have is the increase for the bi-yearly codification update for the town clerk's budget. The only change in the registrar is an additional probably $5,000 to cover the state and federal elections that are going to be happening in September and November. But other than that, we're level funded.
All right. Nope. Okay. Thank you. We're off. No, you said the Board of Health?
I don't believe I see them here tonight.
No?
Level funded budget, I believe.
No, I thought there was an increase. They're in one of the liners.
Okay, so no, I don't see it. Increase is 510 is the budget number on page 70.
All right. So Board of Appeals has nothing?
No increase there.
And the vet agent?
Increase there. Right, the 7,000. Less.
So the vet agent dropped a little bit?
No, it went up by about $7,000, and it's based upon our recent history. It's a very difficult budget to calculate because Massachusetts has the most generous veterans benefits laws in the nation. And so this is our best guess based upon past experience.
Although a lot of this gets reimbursed though, by the state.
75%, right?
75% of the eligible cost gets reimbursed, but that can take 18 months to 2 years to see back.
All right, and then we have Historical Commission.
They're not coming.
And they have they have no increase in their budget.
Level
no
funded. Increase.
While we're talking Historical Commission, have they said anything about their historical work they're doing on the North Hadley Hall?
I did inquire about that. I also called up the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission to find out where the preservation restrictions are on that project. I know that Ms. Elizabeth Rabra is working on it, and I don't have a clear answer back from them on that score.
All right, so let's go to our favorite budget, HPAT.
You're on, Miranda. First of all, the budget you got from David is out of date, so.
Thanks.
You apparently use the old figures in the draft budget that I gave him.
Well, yeah, so the draft budget was composed back in January, so all those figures are old.
That's the same one I'm
here.
Special.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to find out what it's going to be like being on the camera close up.
Ma'am, would you like that?
Yes, please.
Yep.
There.
There
you
go.
What's this say?
Go ahead, Richard. I'm good. There.
Oh. I'm going to be extra one because John isn't here. Okay.
All right, Richard.
Of course, I left my reading glasses in the office.
Do you want to borrow these?
No.
Just give us the highlights, Richard.
Yeah. So did you get the amended?
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, I thought I'd read the whole thing so people viewing the meeting can hear it.
You're going to read three pages?
Why not?
How about just hit the highlights?
Yeah, just the highlights is good. Yeah.
Change in your budgets. That's what everybody's been doing tonight.
Yeah, well, I made some changes in this. I've been so flat out this week, I really haven't had any time to prepare anything other than make a few changes to this old narrative. So bear with me. Let's see. Up until this year, the town's been able to keep the funds from Charter Communications in gift accounts. And this past year, the DOR notified the town that can't do that anymore because it's not considered a gift because the charter is contractually obligated to give us that money. And so we have to find a new place for the money to go. Let's see. Better if I could just read this.
So how about I ask you a couple of questions on what your increases are?
Pardon me?
So in your budget, you have increased your equipment repair line.
From 500 to 1500.
Yes.
Do you have equipment that's breaking down, or?
Let me just read this, because I've made some changes.
All right, go ahead.
During FY 2000, I'll skip this, because that's what I just told you about. Let's see, age past money will have to be moved to a new account by the end of FY 2016. June 30th of this year. If this is not done, all the funds in the gift accounts would be transferred to the general fund and considered free cash for the town to use in whatever way it sees fit, which is a major violation of the terms of the town's cable TV license and charter. The Massachusetts Department of Revenue is currently considering giving all Massachusetts cities and towns a one-year extension on the above stated deadline to June 30th, 2017. And I've just been told that they would be making the extension official sometime in April. I guess when their next newsletter comes out. In our original FY 2017 budget request submitted to you, I requested that HPAT be designated as a self-supporting enterprise as the water and sewer departments currently are, and that the Charter Communications funds be moved to two newly created enterprise funds. The other option I had was to request that the charter money be moved to revolving accounts. Both of these options had major shortcomings. I chose the enterprise fund route because it was basically the lesser of two evils. Fortunately, about 2 weeks after I submitted our budget request, I received word from Massachusetts DOR that they have created a new type of account called a PEG Access and Cable Related Fund. After looking over the regulations governing that type of fund and discussing it with the HPAT Advisory Committee, who were supposed to be here tonight, I have decided that this type of fund is a much better fit for HPAT's needs than the enterprise fund would be. For one thing, we would not be subject to the hefty administrative fee that goes along with the enterprise funds, which would have put our budget request well over the amount we expect to receive from Charter this year, and in my opinion is a violation of the town's cable TV license with Charter, as portions of the fee go to support town expenses unrelated to HPAT. If you went the enterprise route, you would be jeopardizing approximately $530,000 in future funding from Charter for HPAT in order to have an additional $15,000 to $20,000 a year to help balance the budget. I do not think that anyone would agree that such a risk is worth taking. The only problem with PEG Access and cable related funds is that the anticipated revenue cannot be appropriated by town meeting from the fund, while it can be with an enterprise fund. The reason that this could be a problem is because Charter makes its annual payment for HPAT's operating expenses in early June, which, as you know, is about a month after town meeting is held. This is not going to be a problem for us, as we are in the process of changing Charter's annual payment to four quarterly payments, thus they will have paid us 50% of the annual payment by town meeting time. And also, because I've been so tight with HPAT's funds from the previous cable TV license and the current one, we have been able to build up a nice nest egg that can be used to cover the other 50% of HPAT's operating expenses for any given fiscal year until a third and fourth quarter payments are received from Charter.
Richard, on the enterprise fund,
yeah.
is that a legal opinion? or is that, I mean, is that your personal opinion, or is there, do you have reason to believe?
It's basically my personal opinion. I tried to get a legal opinion from Attorney Solomon, but I haven't heard anything back from him.
Okay, I was just wondering. Go ahead.
Yeah. Let's see. Station manager and production assistant pay. The amount that I'm requesting for my pay and my production assistant's pay includes a 5% increase for the HPAT station manager, which is 2% COLA and 3.5% step, and a 2% COLA increase for HPAT production assistant, even though she probably deserves more. I have been receiving a 5.5% increase in my pay every year since I returned to HPAT in November 2011, with the exception of FY 2016 when I received a slightly lower COLA increase. I strongly feel that myself and my production assistant should get a pay raise at the above stated rate, regardless of what the select board decides to give to the other non-union employees whose HPAT can afford it, and it will not affect the tax rate at all because 100% of our pay comes from the charter grant money. Also, the results of the Alliance for Community Media's most recent salary survey, which was released two days ago, shows that I am underpaid by about $10,000 a year compared to the salaries of station managers of other public access stations of similar size.
David, do you know when we're going to have that wage study?
Working on it. Shortly.
Is HPAT included in there?
Yes.
Excellent.
Okay.
You probably want that information too.
Yes, that would be good information.
Richard, could you get that survey information to David?
Yes. Part of it is in your the handout, the last page.
Okay, yep, got it. Thank you.
And Dish TV, which is satellite, which we use for NASA Network and Classic Arts Showcase and Charter Internet, these amounts budgeted assume that the cost for these services will remain unchanged over the next fiscal year. And the health insurance includes the premium increase that went into effect on March 1st of this year, but does not include any increase that might occur effective March 1st, 2017. Trade organization fees, $250 for Alliance for Community Media, 1 year organizational membership, and $100 for Mass Access, 1 year organizational membership. These memberships give me access to, how should I put it, well, the listserv I subscribe to, where I can get advice on public access related problems that I might encounter. It also includes discounts to conferences, and the $100 for Mass Access, that also includes access to their server, which will allow me, well, give me a broader choice of programming to air than what we have now. Equipment, I had asked for no money for equipment purchase in HPAT's original budget request because I did not think I needed to, as funding for equipment purchase would come from HPAT's capital expenses account. I realized later that that has to be appropriated by town meeting as well. So I'm asking for $10,000 for equipment purchases. I currently have no plans for this money. It is mainly in the budget as a contingency in case some of our equipment fails and needs to be replaced. Without it, if a piece of equipment were to fail, we would have to make do without it until the next town meeting, which could be months away.
Can we request a reserve fund transfer? Or is this money different?
You can, but I built into the enterprise fund for the HPAT a mini reserve fund of $10,000 for that purpose that Mr. Truswell is talking about. In the same way as we have for water and sewer, we have enterprise reserve funds for unanticipated and unexpected expenses.
And that's on the warrant?
That's in the omnibus budget.
Budget, yeah, okay.
Okay, certain equipment, i.e. our server slash automated cable caster, video camera, audio mixer, whatever, were to fail and we did not have the funds available to replace it, it would greatly hinder HPAT's operations until the next town meeting. Equipment repair, I've asked for $1,000 in HPAT's original budget, which was a $400 increase over what was budgeted for our FY 2016 budget. I'm asking for $2,000 in my amended budget request. After thinking about it, I decided that $2,000 is a more realistic figure than $1,000 is, given that one repair to our server could run as much as $800 or more, considering that its purchase price was $12,000. Funding sources for HPAT's budget, $57,110 would come from operating budget, operating expenses fund, and which is approximately $5,000 to $10,000 less than what we expect to get from Charter this year for operating expenses, and $10,000 would come from capital expenses fund. And please remember when reviewing this budget that the funding source for the entire request is Charter Communications grant money, not tax revenue.
Okay, any questions? No. Thank you, Richard.
Okay. So, have you decided what sort of, what type of account you're going to move the Charter grant money to?
Actually, no. That's something else for us to talk about tonight.
Yeah. I know the HPAT Advisory Committee is strongly in favor of the PEG fund account, to the point that they're willing to make a motion on town meeting floor to amend the article. So,
thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Okay, so that's all the budget presentations, right?
That's all that we have for tonight, and I think that brings you up to all of the budgets, and there's more articles to discuss.
We have Chief's on here.
Yeah, but that's
not
a
budget.
Oh, it was still on this.
Yes, yeah. That's for the warrant article discussion.
I see. I didn't want to hold them up.
It's fine. I appreciate that, but it's fine.
So, do you want to do a quick summary of the budget, or do you want to go to the warrant?
Let's just go to the warrant.
What? I think everybody okay
well,
with that?
Because we could incorporate the budget within the warrant articles.
No, I don't think so.
Right, you know, there's some stuff there. We'll skip it tonight.
All right, so we have a request for a new warrant article, is why the chief's sitting here.
Yeah.
Go ahead, chief.
I'll be quick. This is a proposed bylaw that we'd like to have the town vote on at town meeting. It is for an adoption of a non-criminal version of a minor transporting or minor in possession of alcohol charge. Right now, the enforcement options that police officers have when they encounter somebody who's under 21 and they possess or are transporting alcohol is arrest or summons, both of which are obviously criminal. while that sometimes may need to happen, what we'd like to do is, what I'll say is, that's bad in a number of ways. Number one, it could potentially add a criminal charge to a young person's record for a relatively minor offense. It takes the officer off the road for, if they place this person under arrest, for however long the booking may take, the report and criminal complaint that follows,
court
and all the other things that go along with it. What we'd like to propose is a bylaw which gives our officers a third option, which is a non-criminal option, and it would bring some revenue into the town. What I'm proposing is a bylaw that is similar to our noise bylaw, allowing officers a third option to write a ticket, essentially, for $300. If the person who's been issued the ticket still would like to challenge it in court, they would have the right to do so and simply not pay the ticket, at which point it can switch to a criminal complaint and they can go and be heard by a magistrate. If not, and they would simply rather pay the fine and move on, $300 check to the clerk's office, and we encounter these so often, we thought that it has multiple positives for the town.
What other towns have adopted it, Mike, or something similar?
A lot of towns have bylaws as it relates to alcohol, like open containers and things like this. I think the town of Amherst actually does something just like this. Mm-hmm. It's similar to the medical, or I'm not sorry, not the medical marijuana, but similar to the marijuana change where we added a $300 bylaw for mm-hmm. simple possession of marijuana, non-criminal. A lot of people are making these changes like these when you can make a bylaw that mirrors the actual law and the town can bring in some revenue instead of putting a criminal charge on someone's record like that. I see that as a win-win.
So what
it makes for expensive beer, doesn't it?
Exactly, very expensive.
So if they had possession of beer being a minor, that wouldn't go on the record if they paid a $300 fine?
Correct. Obviously, there'll be certain situations where
there's other behavior.
Choose another enforcement option, but we run into this so often. We actually, depending on the time of year, for example, the Blarney blowout, we worked with UMass and with Amherst for the 5 weekends as we approached the Blarney blowout at the package stores, and probably could have brought in, Sergeant Cook gave me some basic numbers, we could have brought in $4,500 to $5,000 just in the people that we caught in a 2 or 3 hour period on the weekend days before that.
It's a nice little chunk of change.
And that's you know, when we're actually trying and looking for it. So a lot of times, you know, the officers will pull somebody over and it just happens.
I think that when you first brought this to me, we weren't really concerned that much about the revenue part of it. Is that we live in a digital age, and a young person having possession of alcohol when they shouldn't have, maybe making a poor choice, that information now stays with them forever. If then we have to go to the criminal route, young lives are affected by things like that. It's something that a potential employer or security background check or university could look up. And, you know, out of concern for Hadley's young folks, we thought that this was a better option for us.
I think we have police that we have working for us now are a little bit more considerate of this going on now than what we've had in the past, and I certainly would be in support of this. So do we need to open the warrant?
Hold on, Mr. Devine.
I know, but I'm just asking a question.
We would need
to open the warrant.
But that's what I'm asking.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Well, Mr. Devine's been waiting over here while you two kept talking and talking.
Well, it's okay. He'll have his chance. I'm sure.
I'm just waiting.
How did I get indicted for that? I didn't even say anything.
Is there any way to monitor how many of these offenses occur? I mean, if somebody's up to their ninth one, and we find out that it's not, that $300 becomes a joke or something, I'm not looking to escalate the money, but I'd like it to be, you know, an arrestable offense at some point in time if it's determined that we have a habitual offender.
Absolutely.
Okay, it's at the determination of the officer, of the arresting officer.
Absolutely. When we run into these individuals, a simple name check in our computer system will tell everything we need to know about the person, if we've ever dealt with them before, how many times, what we've dealt with them for. All of that information will pop up, and the officer will be able to make a decision right at roadside.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So
I'll make a motion to open the warrant.
Before we do that, hold on.
I'm just making the motion. Does anybody want to second it?
I want to ask a quick question. do we have other things we have to add to the warrant or delete from the warrant as well?
Well, we would like to get the writing back from DEP on the borrowing articles. I regard that as editorial changes to a warrant. The Capitol Committee is meeting on Monday, and they're going to recommend consolidation of all the capital articles into one article, and so we could reduce another two or three articles from the warrant from that. That would be a recommendation that we would make back to the Select Board on Wednesday. So I regard those kinds of editorial changes as something that you can do without having to go through the formality of opening and closing a warrant. But if we're going to add something completely new and different, we should add that through the opening and closing warrant process.
I'll second the motion.
All right. Any more discussion?
Yeah, I would say let's wait till next week and do it once and to incorporate everything.
We only have to do this one.
Okay.
Okay, so we only have to do this one. We're not expecting to open the warrant any again.
I don't know of anything that would tell us that we need to reopen the warrant.
All right. So any more discussion?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Make a motion for this to go on as a warrant article.
Okay. Is there a second to add this?
Second.
Any more discussion about this one? So you took out the option, the really, really old school option of just taking the kid home and
beating them at the sink.
That's what your parents did to us.
Oh, the parents are supposed to do that now.
Don't you remember that? You get taken home by the cops and it was worse than being arrested.
I got a slipper once in a while.
All right. So, all right. So there's a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
I'll make a motion that we close the warrant.
Second.
All right. Any more discussion about it? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Still on a honeymoon period there,
Chief. Well, the budgets haven't been approved yet.
Okay, thank so.
You. Thank you, Chief.
Any change in the present warrant?
I think we have the building committee here to talk to us about their warrant articles, so we will let them come forward and talk about their articles.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
You did get something back in regards to the first one on the building maintenance budget. I hope, I trust.
Tim, I saw that there was an email from me to me. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes. Okay.
Let me go make copies of that.
Do you want to wait for those copies?
Yeah, we can probably go through the other ones quickly.
Okay.
Okay. The second one was the capital request. Again, we were hoping tonight to have all those figures for you. Certainly, we have to go through Monday night with the capital committee. But the one we still have yet to really know, when we really want a better estimate from the architect, is the public safety complex roof. Certainly, I've talked to you in the past, it's been delayed with regard to the specs and everything. He has promised me as of this morning that we will have a price, an estimate on Friday, so we can have that for Monday's meeting, and then I can get that over to you. We have yet to fill in those estimates on that table.
What number is that one?
It would be number 14.
Okay.
So on that line item, the capital request, I'll just go quickly down that list of things that we are hoping to have on that for projects. The first one, again, is the roof replacement. The second one for public safety is a repair of the sally port insulation above in the ceiling. What that's going to curtail, we did not do that with the rest of the work that we did this past year. And the reason is in order to do that insulation, we have to actually take down the ceiling to do a better and best job. So that has two parts, the insulation. Right now we're hoping we have an estimate of $7,000. Again, I'll get you, we'll get you an updated cost. And the ceiling replacement, take it down, put it back up, is going to be about $4,500. The next item was at the public safety complex was to install catwalks for the mechanical areas. Right now, you have to crawl over the roof trusses to do that. Very unsound to do that. We have a $10,500 price tag right now for that. The next item is at the senior center. We've talked about the on the south side of the building, the very old little doorway that went into the cafeteria, and there's a drain there. So because we don't know right now what we're going to do with the safety complex. Our decision is just to cap that area so water does not get in there.
You meant the senior center?
Yes. What did I say?
You said, you went back to safety complex.
Oh, I'm sorry. Safety complex. I apologize. So we're just going to build a cover over that for now until we determine what's going to happen with that building. The next item is the Department of Public Works, the painting of the gables. We have an $8,000 at this time estimate to scrape and paint those. There is almost no scraping left to do because most of the paint's off.
There's no paint left.
Most of the boards have let go.
Yeah, most of the boards are.
Are we going for green?
DPW gables?
Yes.
In the barn? In the, I mean, not the barn. In the pole barn or in the?
No, in the existing.
The block building.
The block building. Above the block walls, right at the ends on both sides of the roof is wooden gable ends.
Oh, it's wood?
It's wood, yeah.
It's tongue and groove boards. If they're so weathered, a lot of them started to split. So it might be, another option might be to either put, you know, vertical corrugated metal siding or possibly vinyl siding.
Yeah, we might even put vinyl siding on it. The next item and is the town hall parking. We're really getting concerned about what's happening out there. If you go out there, there's some visual areas that are actually sinking. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we did this past year was to fix the ramp. We noticed there was a lot of water getting into the basement in the back corner. That'd be the southeast corner. And there was some damage to the ramp from the downspout. We thought that the water was actually coming in from that damaged area. It turns out it hasn't. And it's coming from someplace else in that back corner. And it's really getting to be problematic. You notice this little dip in the floor out here? It's getting worse. And what has happened is that the column down in the basement that holds all that area up is made out of brick. The brick is now deteriorated to the point that the column is actually collapsing slightly. Why is that? That's because of all this excessive water that's getting in. If you look down there, there looks almost like a stream bed with all the fine sand that's coming through the exterior wall. So there's something happening out in that parking lot. You can see there's a dip. And we believe that there probably is an old well of some sort that's now collapsing and might be tied into a pipe that used to go into the town hall at that area. We also remember that's up until the mid to late 80s. Actually, we had the shed out there that was the old
watershed later.
Yeah, right.
Between the buildings?
Yeah. No, it was over on the other property.
Okay. That was right here in the corner?
Corner, yeah.
But I think there's something down there that has now deteriorated to the point that we're getting excessive amounts of water into the
building. A leak.
But this could turn out to be a very large ticket item. We have right now $60,000 in that. We really need to get the architects and engineers to evaluate. We're going to have to do something up there.
Do we need to discuss it with the owners? Aren't we going to have to dig up that parking lot?
Well, we will have to talk to the church because, quite honestly, that's in on their property.
That's what I mean.
A portion of that.
So we're going to have this ready for our town meeting?
Yes. Well, not for the town hall parking lot, though.
Okay.
But everything else will be ready.
At a minimum, though, I mean, just based on what you said, should we be replacing the failing brick column with a lolly column or something?
We're We're watching it right now.
It needs to be repointed eventually, the mortar's letting go.
So the brick will hold?
We're watching it now. What I'd like, my thought process is, I wanted to wait to see what happens, and maybe we'll do some temporary shoring until all the work outside's done.
Yeah, okay.
And if we have to, we can just do some temporary shoring if we need to, but I'd hate to go through.
Timmy, are you going to blame that vibrating machine that's going to be outside?
So yes. do we actually need to add this into the number we're talking about now? I mean, so we're going to add all this together to be in this one article?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So next meeting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you'll be have that, yeah.
Yes.
Can I just ask a question about that? On the public safety complex roof?
Yes.
Right? And I'm just going to ask, because I'm sure people at home are thinking about it, to the extent within the next handful of years we were to do anything with that safety complex, even an addition or a reconfiguration of the safety complex, would that roof be a throwaway, or is the majority of it would stay in place and maybe just a portion to the side?
It would stay in place. Truss roof. You would not want to play around with that roof at all.
Okay.
It would, yes, it
just
would stay
intact.
Just want
to verify that.
Yes, that's a good point.
So we did borrow, or we approved borrowing, haven't done the borrowing for $150,000 for the replacement of the public safety complex roof. You're thinking that the $150,000 is insufficient for?
We want to be cautious about it. I mean, again, our hope was that all this would have been done and out to bid, we would have had an exact figure beforehand. That hasn't happened, unfortunately. So we have pressured the architect to give us some type of factual estimate, and he has been reluctant to do that until we have, he felt comfortable with the way the specs are written. And we did not approve the specs last night. We have some comments. We gave him those comments yesterday. He accepted them, and he's making a revision to that. He feels comfortable that by Friday he can give us a good feel if that 150 is okay.
Okay.
And it might not be.
Because I've got the bid documents ready to roll as soon as I get the green light.
Yes, and we were hopeful that, but we found some things that we really were concerned about.
Okay.
And if we didn't think that it was written to our liking enough to allow enough people to bid on it.
Okay.
So he agreed. He understood what we were asking for, and he said he'll have those ready.
All right.
Okay. Let's go back to the first warrant article.
So, did you take off the countertops for town hall?
Oh. I'm sorry.
That's under the.
That's under the first one.
Okay.
That's still on.
It's still on.
All right. Let me go fetch that information that you emailed me, and I'll. Don't make copies. I'll be right back. Do you want to talk about the land? That would probably be helpful.
Yep.
Yes.
Well, let's go talk about the North Island land purchase. We have a price that we'd like to put in there.
Do you have an RFP? Or are we just going to do a price thing about the RFP for the land?
I thought there was one that went out.
That was up.
There was an RFP out for land in the center of town.
There was supposed to be one for the north, too.
Yeah.
I don't believe we actually did that one.
There was written up.
I think he did.
He did?
I don't know if it's out, but it was.
I thought it was out.
Okay, we'll have to check on that.
Okay.
So what's your placeholder number you want to put in here?
$550,000. Now, how we came up with that is take the three building lots, multiply it, and you're going to come up to about that price.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. What size building lot? An acre?
Wow.
What are you looking at here for 550?
That was that entire lot. How many acres was that?
Over nine, I believe.
Nine.
Yeah, it was nine acres.
Nine.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions about that one, or anything else you want to talk about that one?
No, I think we're just looking for a number.
So we have to check and see where the RFP
is. Yeah, we need to find out that.
You want to talk about the consultant?
Yes. We're still looking to add on to that, again, $50,000 again. We've gone through about 22,000, I believe.
Something like that.
Around 22,000, but that does not include a couple other ones we still do not have estimates on that we wish to have done in the springtime. That included the some work on the library. One of the projects that we talked about last night with the library is, it's been ongoing for quite some time. It has to do with the ceiling on the first floor. Remember, that's extremely loose. And we have this floor structure analyzed. It came out to be sound, but the ceiling itself is pulling away from the floor joists. That needs to be replaced before the entire thing comes down. We've had a couple times we have patched it, taken areas down and replaced it. We need to really do the entire ceiling so it is safe for everybody. With that, the library was going to do revamp all the lights. That design's been done by the library. It's ready to start. What we found out was where that knob and tube is also in that ceiling, and it goes down in the front stairwell. All the knob and tube, apparently from the entire building, follows the same path down into the breaker box. If you open that wall up, if there's any knob and tube, it is required to be replaced by code. So we're going to have to replace all the wiring that goes up to the second floor. We're just going to go up to the second floor and put in another box up there, circuit breaker box, and cap everything off there. But when we have everything open, we might as well clean out all that knob and tube, change it over, and get it ready. Now, yeah, it might be a library, it might not be a library, but that ceiling has to be dealt with soon. We've been repairing it too many times. So they have some money already appropriated for it. We're supposed to be getting another estimate on that, and one of the things that we want to do in the future is secure some more funding and do the entire project for that.
For the library?
Yeah.
Is there a number you want to throw out there?
Is there something I'm missing here if we're going to be tearing that building down?
We're not tearing down the library.
We don't know what we're
doing.
We
don't know that yet.
We're not.
We don't know what we're doing
with
the building.
We don't know what we're going to do with it.
So is there a number?
So we're going to be the keeper of another building.
Easy.
Wonderful.
It might go to the feds. That was one of the options.
Go where?
To the federal government for the Agricultural Visitor Center. I think that was a great thought of dealing with that building.
Okay, so
where am I at? But those are some of the projects that our architect has slated to do. That's why we need the extra $50,000 to go
for the $50,000. Okay. All right. And then the previous project article is just wrapping up.
Yeah, there's just some line items. That's for the building maintenance budget. Right now, under highway, you have $66,950.
You're talking about
which one?
Reallocation of previous
number 17. Yeah.
Oh, I apologize. All the other projects that we've done in the past, remember, we pigeonholed some of the money, and David's helping us come up with some verbiage for that, just to instead of throwing it back totally into the free cash or whatever, that we can get it and put it into an account
Right.
Those are things I've given the DPW. We had $3,500 left over in the insulation. We were short for the windows of $3,000-some-odd. It would have been nice if we could have just had those other windows done at the same time. But it'll give us the ability to take that money and use it for the different buildings.
Any other questions about those?
I'd just like to make a comment about the land purchase that he mentioned, $550,000. Initially, when we purchased the land for the safety complex and the school, they wanted $750,000. We negotiated them down to $525,000. What a gift that is today for 17 and a half acres that we purchased at that time. And the townspeople quabbled about it. And today it comes, it was a blessing we bought it, and we have our school and our safety complex on that site.
Thanks.
RFP, we were gonna ask them to the land.
Yes.
Oh, the RFP.
Do we actually do an RFP for the north, or we haven't put that one out yet?
Not for the north, but you did do one for the center village, and that's due on April 15th.
Okay, I guess we should talk about the north one then. Okay.
Is there a number on that one, Governor?
Is there a number?
Yeah, for the one in the center.
The bids aren't due, but.
Not yet.
Oh, okay.
Proposals aren't due.
Proposals. Thank you.
Okay, so we have the information about your building maintenance?
Building maintenance. We talked about that a lot. The highway building maintenance is at $66,950. We talked about the $200,000 figure. You wanted some idea where that money would be expended. We gave you a very short list of number of items that came up to $75,200. That would bring the grand total up to $142,150. But these are just some of the critical ones that we see right now. So there is only a difference of $58,000 there that we can discuss where you'd like to propose for the first time if we can raise that maintenance budget up.
Okay, so.
He's right.
We have 66, you're itemizing the 140 to 12.
They're actually itemizing 75 to 12.
Right, we're trying to, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But I think you also have to look at the building maintenance budget right now of $66,950 and see which ones are actually already expended.
Exactly.
Almost all of them are.
Yeah, yeah. So we run out of money. Mm-hmm.
So last year we transferred $100,000 from the Russell School account. There's $95,000 left in that account. We've agreed that we're going to reserve a certain amount for the HVAC project, which is likely to need additional funding.
Yes.
So rough figuring, you still have $50,000-$60,000 in this account that you can use for municipal building repairs. Is that figured into here, or is there a separate plan?
We don't think it's that high. We don't think there's that much money in that account anymore, quite honestly.
Well, I reviewed it with the accountant, so.
We don't have those figures, that's our problem.
I know you have 95 in there.
So another question we had was whether you had talked it over with the new DPW director and got his opinion, since it's kind of in his budget. He's laughing, and he must have talked it over.
Well, we did talk about the work order system, and he does have a figure for him, purchasing that and getting it installed, and we did not add that into there.
Okay, so as we look at the amount of money just laid on the table, it's a lot.
Mm-hmm.
If we, as the select board, have to put this in some type of order, do you have a preferred preference of what order we would put it in?
mean, you have safety written next to electrical upgrades at the DPW. I'm going to have to think that that...
Yeah.
Yeah, that was...
That's a priority.
Right.
That's a priority. That was, that's a required upgrade that's been told.
So actually, I guess, since you're coming back to tell us a little more about a couple of these next week, if you would think about how you want to...
Prioritize.
Eat this large elephant. Which bite we eat first? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, we just keep on stretching it out, but we understand where you're coming from. You know, we understand it.
Okay.
I mean, the mere fact is that we have still a lot of catching up to do. It's going to take us some time. We thought that these were items that are critical enough that we should take care of. Can we put one or two of them off, like the painting? Yeah, but it just means that the next time, that budget's going to get even greater, because you're going to have more to deal with.
We understand that.
Yeah.
But
we can help you.
Well, okay.
One thing to remember, too, if we're talking about getting a work order system going, right now we're just basically, you know, if something's bleeding real bad, we go and stop the bleeding. And other than that, it's mostly contractual services and stuff that are in these budgets. We're not doing, like, you know, new carpet in a room until it's completely, you know, you're tripping over it, you have to do it.
Okay.
So if we started, you know, once you start a work order system, people are going to be putting their wish list out. It's just going to become a stack if we don't have any money to actually do stuff above and beyond the stuff that's just has to be done. Or
it does. Mm-hmm. But then again, if you're looking at a really good work order system, you actually need a really good computer system to run it on.
That's right. What that,
so let's see. Now we're back to our IT issue. So we're actually just making a big circle here and smiling as we walk
that
by.
That was some of our discussion, because I'd like to intertwine all the other DPW departments into that work order system. That's part of the, mm-hmm. You know, the maintenance software, if that needs to be different, or can we get all in one?
Yes.
It's expensive, but I know we can do it. It's just what fits for everything we have here.
Does that include, it doesn't likely include it, but the timekeeping system is also something that we wanted to look into. My understanding is we have disparate time clock systems,
mm-hmm.
And kind of getting everybody on the same playing field at some point. So are you going to be coming back with a proposal on the work order, or did you want to share more information tonight, or?
Me?
Yeah.
That was just the small discussion
An
we had.
An off-the-cuff conversation.
Well, as observations I've made in four weeks here, there's a lot of things we can use the work order system for.
Mm-hmm.
Accountability, equipment, especially hours of equipment maintenance we're doing on equipment. It provides nice reports when we're wanting a piece of equipment or needing a piece of equipment. Let me
mm-hmm.
rephrase that.
Well, you're looking at over $16,000 for that type of system.
How much?
$16,000
plus. 1.6?
Yes.
1.6.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
For a work order system?
Yeah, we purchased Cartograph.
Like 60, really.
Yeah, we purchased Cartograph at my last job, and it was, I think it was $18,000, but my previous employer is a much larger, a lot more things going into it.
Is it going to save us money in the long run and institute accountability?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay.
The caveat is
you can buy it for you.
That's actually not, you got to actually use it to get that part.
Well,
exactly.
You have to buy it, you have to commit to it, you have to have employees commit to it.
Well, that's why I'm thinking that whole time clock thing is probably something to be looking at the same time.
It's a matter of getting ideas from other communities that have these systems and what they have in them, and what would fit Hadley the best too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got Cartograph, you've got Utility Cloud, there's just a whole mess of systems out
Facility
there.
Facility Dude. I think that's the coolest name, Facility Dude.
Yeah, that's another one.
They
use out east.
That's just a cool name. I mean,
sometimes the standard hardware comes in 17,000, 18,000, and then there's it bumps it up when you get into the whole water and sewer thing, because the software is a little different. You get into scheduled things and all that stuff. I mean, I don't want to get into all the nuts and bolts tonight, but we have been talking about it a little bit.
Okay.
I got it in my notes that I've been making.
It's on your list.
Yeah.
Be good for the IT thing.
And that's key. We got to have the IT support. I mean,
mm-hmm.
You don't know, you can buy the best system in the world, but if you don't have the IT support, then...
Yeah.
That's useless, sir.
Do you have any questions of our committee?
Do we have any questions?
Anything that you'd like to...
Not tonight, I don't think.
So let's actually take a step...
I have one more of them.
One question? Sure.
Okay. I've been spending a lot of time in the Council on Aging building, and elderly people are going up and down the stairs, having a very difficult time. And I says, why aren't you using the elevator? She says, we don't trust it anymore. It's breaking down so much, and we're getting caught in it. Can you give me an update what's really happening with that elevator?
We can't get parts for it.
You can get up there. It takes them a while.
Very, very...
When we bought that elevator, or, well, I wasn't here, that was an obsolete elevator
when it was installed.
So a nice quick summation of what's wrong.
It just breaks down a lot.
Yeah, it was obsolete when we bought it, so they quit making that style. So trying to get parts for something that hasn't been made, I mean, they can get them, but the problem is, you know, it's like an old car. A lot of guys, they come out and they work on it, and something else is wrong with it the last time that it broke.
Okay.
It's a problem.
Thank you.
All right. So let's actually back up a little bit. And I was just going through my list of what we've kind of already voted on, what we have answers to. So we need to wrap up the warrant by...
So on your meeting of April 6th, it would be great if we had a warrant that we could send to council for review. On April 13th, it would be great if council had that warrant back to you so you could sign it. We can post it after April 13th. The absolute deadline for posting your warrant is April 28th, Thursday, the last Thursday of the month. If we're not posting, then we don't have a town meeting, so.
So we...
But we can still have a warrant and affix numbers to what
we need to. We can change the numbers, yes.
So all we need is the...
So I think your work of next week is to listen to the recommendation of the Capital Planning Committee, consolidate all of these capital articles into one capital article, get the word back from DEP that we don't have to do the borrowing for Route 9 anymore, since we're already authorized to do that. And I think you can knock down four or five articles off this, tighten up the rest of it, and we're off to the races.
Okay. So that's what's what we're shooting for, if you don't mind. Thanks.
No.
We'll...
Cool.
We have to do it.
I didn't say that earlier, did I? I guess I did. All right. Good job. All right. So actually, let's talk about the article for capital. I know you want to shorten it up to one article. I think we should not do that. I think we need to pull two pieces of the capital out and have it as their own article, and that would be the RFQ for the OPM and the money for the land in the center of town, and then take all the other pieces and put them in an article by themselves.
Okay.
When you look at the draft language you gave us today, deciding to go with a consultant for the senior center, park and rec, and whatever else we build next, and deciding to buy land in the center of town are probably the two biggest things we have to talk about besides the library issues. And to have them mixed in with five other items, I think kind of does a disservice to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, as I would propose, and if everyone agrees, we would pull those two out. That is the lead capital article.
One and three.
Mm-hmm. One and three, and then the other five go together as this is general capital stuff.
Mm-hmm. And then people will be able to line item. We've done that in the past where we've had multiple items, and people voted not the entire article as a block, but...
That's for us. I guess we could do that.
Yeah, it'll depend on the funding source. If we're borrowing for particular items, we'll have to have different motions for each borrowing authorization.
Okay. So is everybody in agreement with that?
I don't have a problem with that at all. Are you going to make one article of one and three, or are you going to make three articles out of this?
No, I would put one and three together.
Okay.
So we can sit down and talk about the whole process at once. Mm-hmm. If it's two separate articles, you got to talk about it here, and you got to talk about it again. But if it's one article, we talk about the whole goal of this article,
and then we move forward.
But on the land purchase, it's actually purchases.
It's actually, this one here is just for the
center town.
For the center town.
And we're not gonna do the one for North Hadley on this?
The one on North Hadley is another article by itself.
By itself, okay.
Okay.
Yeah, makes sense.
All right, so let's move with that approach on that, and then we're not gonna open those, we're not gonna get those until the 15th, except the land is due on the...
15th, so...
The RFQs are due on the...
15th as well, so we can put in, a sum of money. There are a number of ways that we can construct this particular...
Let's just put a number in.
Yeah, either put in a number, or I think this is legal to do, we could put in the words "a sum of money," quote unquote.
I think this is legal to do.
I'm pretty sure.
Makes me uncomfortable.
I'm pretty sure that that's...
That makes me uncomfortable too.
I'm pretty sure.
I think we put a number in and change it.
Obviously wanna check it out with council first.
I'm as sure as...
No, let's just put a number in, and we'll change the number, 'cause that's easier to, 'cause you gotta, when you amend it, you gotta say we're deleting this word and changing this word, right? So if we're just deleting a number, it's...
Got it.
I think it'd be easier for us.
All right.
So are we gonna put out the RFP for North Hadley property?
The RFP for North Hadley property, I'll talk to David tomorrow, or this week about the next meeting, see where we are. 'Cause we could do the same thing. Yeah, we have to talk about that one. Okay. So, let's run through the ones we haven't taken a position on, and see if we're ready to take a position on it, so...
Okay, so...
Number six?
I think we're starting with number four.
Number four, we've taken positions on.
We've taken another position, but we're gonna have to change the article, so I just wanna make sure that we're comfortable with the change. We have an opportunity to, rent Russell School to a, on a temporary basis to a contractor. This obviously has to be decided by bid. But right now, we don't have a budget to operate the building with a tenant in. So rather than increase the budget and put a burden on the taxpayer, I propose that we run this as a revolving account in the same way as we did with North Star. So I'm proposing that we add a $70,000 line to the revolving account. So the rental proceeds will pay for the operation of the building during the time of the tenancy, and then whatever's left over can be brought over to the general fund.
What's the projected timeline?
Well, it's 14 months is the projected timeline for the Route 9 project.
Year and a half.
Yeah, so...
What's the bridge project projection?
For Russell...
Bay Bridge?
Bay Road?
Bay Road.
Oh, Bay Road, that's June.
That's for the temporary repair?
Yes, June, July.
Then what was the...
Water permitting.
Right.
And then they were gonna expedite the permanent repair, weren't they? Are they looking at 15, 17?
That's another 4 or 5 years.
It's on the TIF.
All right.
And then Russell Brook Culvert is another 4 or 5 years out as well.
Okay.
Same with the other Route 9 widening project, another 4 or 5 years.
Okay, so we only have one project right now going on in town.
The center.
So I'm okay with that.
Center.
What center?
The Route 9 project.
Right, but this would be the extension, would be the another 5 years.
All right, so...
So you need a motion to accept the proposed changes to Article...
No, this is editorial changes, but you do need a motion to see if you want to continue to recommend it.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to recommend.
Well, do we need to make a, do we need to just keep our recommendation as it is?
It says recommend, do you want to just keep it that way?
You recommended 5-0 last time.
Mm-hmm.
It's the inclusion of $70,000 to the revolving fund, which would have no impact upon taxes. Is that still agreeable?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's fine. So then 5, we need to do...
5, you're all set and we got the money in?
Yeah.
So we're good there.
All right, so then are we ready for budget amendments for 16?
So this is the retro pay based upon the contracts? The funding sources right now is proposed to be stabilization interest and sewer reserves and water reserves.
And that's recommended by the Finance Committee?
No, they haven't made any recommendation on that. In fact, they're probably going to debate it.
Are they going to bring it up before the 6th?
Yes, they're going to be talking about it this Saturday.
Should we wait on that one?
We should wait.
I would wait for the recommendation.
All right. Cable TV.
Number 7. So though I've set this up as an enterprise fund. You can do it as a special revenue fund, as Richard has requested. You do need an article in order to take the money that's in the gift account and transfer it over to either the enterprise fund or the special revenue fund.
So what's this other account we're talking about now?
So Richard and I have debated this for months now. My recommendation continues to be that we run it as an enterprise fund. The advantages, the special revenue fund is a place where the money can go, can be transferred in, and then can be spent out for operations and for capital. It looks an awful lot like an enterprise fund. It acts an awful lot like an enterprise fund. There are two things about the special revenue fund that we need to be aware of. One is any interest earned on the amounts goes to the general fund, does not stay with the special revenue fund. So this interest income would be going to the general fund. The other is that you cannot appropriate in advance anticipated revenues. So HPAT gets funded in June, 11 months after the beginning of the fiscal year. So he has to coast on reserves for 11 months before he gets his money in. In most years, that's going to be fine. But at some point, we know that we're going to do major work on senior center, and we're going to do capital upgrades. We're going to be moving HPAT to a temporary location, and then we're going to put HPAT back into a building, and we'll want to do capital upgrades. Under a special revenue account, I don't think you have the reserves to cushion operations and capital upgrades of that magnitude 3 or 4 years from now. In enterprise fund, you would be able to appropriate anticipated revenue, so you don't have that problem. And the interest generated would stay with the enterprise fund so that there would be more money available to HPAT.
In 2 of the years of that contract, there's $75,000 available for equipment, is there not?
That's correct, an additional $75,000.
Have we utilized, or has that been appropriated yet? Has it occurred yet? And if not, could that be put into an account and utilized for the upgrades in the years where the...
Yes, right now, as of January 20th, I have HPAT operational funds equal to $151,000 in change, and there was $74,000 in capital funds in change, and I think there's been some capital expenses taken out of that since then, so it will be a lesser amount. But there'll be another infusion of $75,000 for capital and an annual infusion of something on the order of $65,000 for operations.
In what year?
Every year for the next 8 years.
Wasn't there two years where there was the capital infusion of 75?
2 years for a capital infusion, in the first year and the fifth year.
What year are we in the contract now?
2.5.
Okay.
All right.
So let's... So revolving fund, enterprise fund, those are the two options. Third option is now a PEG.
Special revenue.
Yes. We've gotten information back from the Department of Revenue that the revolving fund is not legally going to do the trick. I don't know why.
Okay, so the PEG is what you just talked about.
It's PEG or enterprise fund.
Okay.
Can you allocate indirect expenses to special revenue fund?
Both of them are the same there. We can do administrative charges for both. So, like I said, it doesn't matter to me this year, but I think in the future the enterprise fund is the better option.
Well, it actually does matter, because once you set up a fund, and you have to, if you decide to change, you have to go through the process of changing it. That's, it's kind of an accounting
And you have to, you have to keep the enterprise fund operating for 3 years before you dissolve it, so that's the other thing.
Richard, you had a statement?
Yeah, the figure he gave you as to how much money we have in the operational expenses account, no offense intended, it's not even close. We have about 98,000 maybe, that last check.
Okay, thank you.
Unless something I'm putting in is being taken out of my account, it's not being taken out of it.
So is there, do you, are we ready to make a decision about this, or do we want to ask for some more information before next week? My only concern would be, I really don't like making a system and then next year or 3 years later changing the system.
Right.
If we have an ability to make a very good decision and set it up the way we really want it to be for a while, we shouldn't do it that way. So
I want to know the numbers too. I want to know flat dead that there's numbers, what they are, and I'd like them in front of me, please. Operationally, we know we're spending about $67,000 a year on the
So if we can get a summary then of what's left over.
And when the influx is coming.
And then a projection of
inflows.
Inflows.
Sure.
And then we can sit down. And then if you can ask the accountant and the treasurer their preference and how they feel about us doing one and changing.
Mm-hmm.
Being someone who went through the process of making an enterprise system and destroying it, it's a pain in the rear end.
Would be to wait a year and see if the DOR comes up with more options for this.
And there's an option too if we actually do get an extension.
Yeah, you can wait for another year if you wish.
But then we have to change our omnibus budget.
Yes, you do.
So why don't we start with where we are,
right,
with what we just asked for, and then we decide where we go from there.
Yep.
Okay.
You might as well do it this year. I don't see any benefit in delaying a year. But because we've been looking at HPAT for a couple of years and looking at how we can tighten it up, might as well do it properly. Which way you want to go, I'm happy with that.
Okay. Omnibus budget, we need to talk a little more about that. Why don't we just, capital, we've kind of taken care of that. We'll get more for next time.
Mm-hmm.
State revolving, we'll know, are we ready to make a decision on that, on number 11?
Just an abundance of caution, I think we should defer, but I want to take 11 and 12 out.
Okay, so then that, we haven't talked about 18, which is the surplus vehicle for fire.
Well, shouldn't we talk about that with Mike here?
That's, do we want to invite him?
I think so.
Yeah, the Capital Committee is going to be interested in 18 and 19 consolidating that into Article 10.
Okay.
Makes sense.
And then we had made the decision that we weren't going to talk about or take a position on 20 and 21 until we did 10.
Mm-hmm.
So that leaves us with our budget. So let's talk budget for a little while.
Are you supporting just to tidy up things. Gooseberry Lane Planning Board has asked us to defer this to the fall.
Yep.
We're okay with that.
Okay. And I assume that you're supporting by 400 the non-criminal disposition?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay,
so the budget?
Park and Rec, number 28.
Was the Turco Park?
Yeah, do we want to weigh in on that one? Because that's kind of tied to, it's tied to a CPA request,
yeah.
And we decided not to do CPA requests.
I just have no idea what they're doing. I mean, I don't know what the 9600 is going to, so I can't tell you, make an educated guess.
So unless we get something next week, we're going to probably give no opinion on that as well.
Right.
No position.
What, to renovate the Turco Park?
Yeah. Okay.
88,000.
So we got our budget update, our omnibus budget update from the town administrator. And would you like to go over that?
Obviously,
what's the bottom line?
Obviously, it's a lot of information. Probably want to take it under advisement.
Looked at it today.
What does next meeting look like?
Next meeting, you're focused almost exclusively on the warrant and the budget. And the budget.
And the budget.
Let me pull it up.
I'd like some time to look at this.
Yeah, and is Finance Committee going to be coming with recommendations?
I will invite them to do so. You're going to have, what have we got?
Capital should have everything wrapped up, I think.
I have your clarifier upgrades construction. It's just an authorization to go out to bid on that one, and electricity aggregation. So not a whole lot on that agenda other than budget and warrant.
I'll only move the electrical aggregation off.
Okay.
All right, so let's just do this next week when we have a chance to look at this.
Well,
just came in there.
Yes, but before we go...
Generic conversation and explain what we have in front of us.
Yes, let's just get the highlights of what we have.
Okay.
Really? Okay.
All right, so the front page is the revenues that we all agreed we were going to use dated January 20th.
Mm-hmm.
They have not been updated by the governor's budget, which came out 7 days later. Second page is the beginning of the warrant of the omnibus budget, and you can see that I have four columns on the right hand side. The first column is just a restatement of the recommended budget that I proposed back in January 20th. I've updated that for the things that you've allowed to update, so $1,500 for the police computer, for example. Next to it is the 1.5% COLA. The next column is the 2% COLA. And then if there is a program expansion, that's in the final column. So I've tallied those for each of the departments. And on page number 4, you'll see the totals. And the final page, page 5. You see the January 20th estimate with a budget gap of $597,000, keeping in mind that the school revised downward their budget, so that's where the savings there was. 1.5% COLA was $610,000 gap. 2% COLA is a $614,000 gap. And if you throw in all the program expansions, the gap is $976,000 and change.
Did you, every one of your members is off about $4,000 from what we have?
By fourth?
On the expenses?
The expenses, are you sure?
Well, see what I'm looking at? Are the same as what you're looking at? Those weren't the numbers you just read.
This gap here, right?
Oh, okay. I see. Gotcha.
Right there.
I'm just looking at the amount that we would need to balance it.
Right.
Okay.
The effect of House 2, the governor's budget, would be to close the gap by $36,000 and change in all of those line items. So that's where we are at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep, and we don't, there are no capital items buried in here, right? All of that's been pulled out?
That's correct.
Yep.
Okay. All right, so is there anything we want to add? Anything else we want to see before the next meeting?
We
want to digest this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we just need the numbers from the building committee.
Yeah.
To add to this.
Yeah.
So that will be the change next week. We'll do those numbers.
We funded the OPEB last year in the fall budget, right?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. How much do we have in certified free cash?
About $1.
Right. And then so...
So any free cash we would use to balance the budget, or undesignated funds would be certified in the fall. So we'd be doing a budget correction in the fall.
In the fall, yeah.
Okay. So anything else?
And last year, we what did we do in the fall? How did we did the OPEB in the fall, we did the raises in the fall? What else did we do in the fall last year?
You deferred a lot of capital.
Yeah.
You also
We should defer the capital again this year. I mean, because there's $30,000 in the capital account, quite honestly, and it's going to be refunded. So the fall, you know, budget with the capital should be another $240,000 estimate.
Yeah.
So a lot of the things that we have that we're going to be looking at there, the, you know, we have $30,000 available right now. How are we going to fund, you know, the projects that, that we have in front of us? So I think in our discussion on Monday night, you're probably going to find out that a lot of those things are going to be pushed off till fall as well. What else did we put us to the fall last year?
You decided to defund the unemployment. You have an operating expense for the North Hadley Village Hall, which if you are going to
utilize for the
if you're not going to have North Hadley Village Hall, you don't need to operate it. You also have funds for maintenance of buildings that can be transferred over to the Russell School. You can tighten up some of the estimates for the operating budgets.
So if you we utilize the same ideology that we used last year, what's the bottom line going to look like? That's what I think. That's the direction I'm heading with this, is that we're probably going to be in a very similar situation where we were last year. Let's figure out how it got done last year, what we put off till the fall, and let's be consistent in our ideology regarding this.
I think we need to, but we're going to have likely significantly less free cash.
Yes.
So that's making it very different from last year.
Because we actually increased the revenues a little bit this year, so kind of.
Yeah, can refresh my memory? What if we had that whole discussion about in the past, whatever the meals tax figure was, that's what went into the capital, right? And like Jerry just said, 240. Our meals tax is actually north of 300 now. Did we decide? We had a whole discussion about.
Yeah, we never decided.
We never made a decision. Okay. No.
What percentage?
What percentage?
Yeah.
So
if we were going to target
we took what
a percentage.
We needed for the budget and whatever was left over stayed in capital.
Yeah.
And not to go below, is that what? The figure that you're talking about, not to go below?
Yeah.
It went into cash, didn't it? Or did you keep it to pull over to the following year?
It was only 30,000 left over.
Is it?
Right.
Well, it was supposed to just sit in cash, and I think last year at fall town meeting we stuck it in the capital.
You stuck about $244,000 into the capital. Two thoughts. You still have other options. We're still waiting for the House Ways and Means budget. There's some thought that the governor underfunded, not that he wasn't generous, but he underfunded the Chapter 70 account. So we can expect to see some sort of boost in that account. You have the local receipts, we didn't increase many of them, which you may want to consider doing. I had advised back in January that we not do that in order to boost free cash in future years.
Right.
But you still have that option of going there. And for the capital, funding the capital with meals tax was a good first start for this community, but knowing what our capital needs are and knowing what the meals tax brings in, there are other things that we need to be doing in order to stay on capital, our capital funding schedule. So we should have a discussion about what that looks like. You know, it's a good start, but it's not sufficient for the long haul.
Well, so where else are you going to come up with money for stabilization or for capital expenditures if you didn't have your meals tax?
If there is a proposal at the back end of the budget that I submitted for capital stabilization account that could be funded in a way that would be in a percentage of the budget.
In the back of this book, right, yeah.
In the back of that book.
Yeah, okay.
I think that might be a good thing to do, is kind of take what Jerry said, kind of list out what we did last year, so we can see what, how that compares with these numbers here.
Yeah.
And if we have that for next week, that would work well. Anything else?
Water and sewer rates, when are we gonna sit down and discuss those? They haven't gone up in 5 years, right?
Haven't gone up since 2008.
Right, and the longer we delay, the further it gets pushed.
But then we also had talked about the new DPW director getting a hold of that and getting a chance to look at that as well.
Right, so I had thought that we would start tackling that on the 6th, but if we don't have enough time on the agenda, we can do it.
I know there are expenses in water and sewer and the enterprise money that's set aside in those accounts, and I think that's one of the things that we looked at over the years, that if we're asking people to fund these other projects that are going to be coming along, we can't keep increasing everything anywhere, even though we haven't touched them in 4 or 5 years, there's still a really a good amount sitting in those accounts. Not enough to take care of the infrastructures that need to be taken care of at this point either, but with the whole picture being on the table right now of all the projects and things that we need to do and what we're going to be asking people to fund, whether it be land purchases or new buildings and the library. I mean, there's just going to be a multitude of things that, you know, people are going to have to look at and think, and what is actually going to be able to come out of their pocketbooks.
Not touching those accounts for 8 years is not,
it's not good.
Good.
No, it's not, but I guess we still have to look at the whole picture right now.
But we don't know what that picture is.
No.
Right.
So we do need to have the DPW director take the information and come back to us so we can actually look at it.
But we do have an idea of what is going to be asked of people.
We're getting that idea, aren't we?
And in and of that self, I think that they have to understand that the infrastructure for water and sewer needs to be looked at as well.
Yeah.
As we talked about, safety being priorities, that infrastructure needs to be taken care of first and foremost, and then the people need to decide what they want to spend their money on. But I don't want to show up after town meeting and say that there's going to be huge water and huge sewer increases, when I'd rather people understood that before they go and vote on their money issues at town meeting.
Well, I think one of the things too, when you're talking about the water and the sewer increases, that we need to have a public informational meeting so that people can talk about it and they're just not all of a sudden hit with that either.
I think it's a great idea, Joyce.
Yeah.
I do.
Okay. Is there anything else we want to do for the budget?
No.
Anything else?
So I would really like to see the finance committee. Hopefully, they can make the next meeting so that we can.
Saturday.
Can
at least know what they're. If they can't come, at least that they can lay out what they want, so we know. All right. I think you have an announcement at the end of the table.
I do indeed, and we're very happy to have Jennifer James as part of our team for the licensing coordinator and for the administrative assistants with the select board. We've had just a couple of days working together. I've enjoyed the time.
Thank you. Thanks for being here. I'm glad to be here. Welcome.
And then we have another person in the audience. How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm a Mandarin, I'm with the Gazette. I am,
You're on camera.
I'm covering Hadley.
So you replaced,
David?
Yep, he took the web editor's position and I took over Hadley.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
We'll be seeing you on a regular basis, we hope.
Yes.
Excellent.
And congratulations for seeing through the whole meeting.
Yes.
I really do. I'm stubborn with my attendance. I have an editor who is wondering where I am.
Okay. Well, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Any other announcements?
I'll take a couple.
Right.
I've been asked to remind people that excise taxes are due on Friday, and that would be April 1st. And it's not April Fool's Day. It's a true, your taxes are due on Friday, April 1st. And we'd also like to extend our condolences to and sympathies to the Wallace Foreman family, and that would be his daughter Christine and her husband Eugene Newman, and then Eddie and Carol Foreman also, which is his son. So our condolences to you all. He was had the Polish club at the beginning of coming on to Route 9 years ago, and I remember my car failing, and I went into the Polish club to see if I could use a phone. Well, guess what? Those lucky men in there, there was no phone because their wives couldn't call them in there. But he also...
You were heading somewhere else with that luck. I thought that was going somewhere else.
No, but I mean, there was literally no phone in that place, so...
How'd you call takeout orders?
There was no takeout orders. That was to go in, and his wife made Polish food, galumpki, and pierogies and things, and they always had good meals there, too, when people stopped in on Saturdays. And his property was always pristine coming into Hadley. He always kept his property very neat and clean, and it was nice to see that when we go into Hadley. So certainly he will be missed.
Any others?
That's all I have.
I see Tuesday night the planning board has, not this Tuesday, but the following Tuesday, little houses is going to be talked about in that. And I know there's a lot of people that are interested in that for town meeting. So tune in, not this Tuesday, but the first Tuesday of the month that they're talking about the little houses.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Yeah, there's one more thing we need to do.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good night, everybody.